What I would like to do now, without further ado, is actually to introduce Paul Horton, who is actually going to talk to us about the work r rangatahi are doing with eels, glass eels, and I'm hoping is going to give us a little bit of a talk about lampreys, because I believe there are some lampreys in this area. I'm going to let Paul introduce himself because he is it's much easier probably for him to introduce himself. Now, if you have a question, could you please put it in the chat room and then Paul will be delighted to answer the questions from the chat room. And also, I should like to advise you that this is being recorded. So if you want to listen to it later again, then just let me know, and I will make sure you get the link to the recording. So without much further ado, Paul, over to you.
Well, kia ora everyone. Thanks for joining the talk tonight. I hope you enjoy what we're about to experience. It's been a pretty awesome process for me. So I'll just bring up my presentation now. There, that one from there. Right, can everybody see that?
Yes, can you make it a full screen, Paul, by chance?
Thought I had. Oh, hang on.
I think if you go to the beginning, I think that's maybe where you.
Right.
If you go to the, from the beginning and
No, not that one. I'll try hang on, do this one. So is that gone full screen now, or are we still?
No, we're not, but I think if you yeah, we'll just carry on, Paul. I'm sure that people can certainly see what is on the screen already.
Hello. I think
Yeah.
if you hit slideshow, you'll be all right.
Right, I'll try that. Hang on.
Start slideshow from current slide.
It's on the left-hand side of your screen on that tab line. You've got from the beginning and then from current slide, that one.
Yeah, that one, current
Yeah,
slide.
yeah.
Is that any better?
No.
Now I'll try one more shot. Let's see. Might be in this one. Right, let's try that. Is that any better?
No, it's still the same, Paul.
All right. Now, we'll see if we can what happens when we make a start. Hopefully, it'll come right. Welcome everyone. So this talk is on glass eel recruitment, juvenile eel surveys and the ongoing Rangitane freshwater fishery stocks assessments and discoveries in the Rongrohe. So just to outline who we are and what we do, and after that I'll introduce my role. Rangitane and Manawatū are part of a four-way Runanga collective known as Rangitane. They are resident in the lower North Island and top of the South Island. So we have Rangitane o Wairau, who are our South Island whānau, Rangitane o Wairarapa, Rangitane o Tamaki Nui Arua, and Rangitane o Manawatū. And I work for Rangitane o Manawatū as the Te Ao Tūroa Environmental Centre officer. Been in the role 16 years now. Rangitane in the present day have a, if you can see that slide, sorry for being slightly smaller, approximately 440,000 hectares, 800 years of occupation. In the present day, we have 700 plus known wahi tapu or sacred sites. They all sit on a GIS database for when we're dealing with RMA consent matters. There's about 6,000 beneficiaries registered with the iwi authority, and our tribal area or ruhi covers five local territorial authority areas, so Horizons, Palmerston North City, Manawatū District, Hora Whenua, Tararua, you'll see there on the south bank of the Rangitika, we also have there. So as is appropriate, no kōrero on any animals or plants is not appropriate without their whakapapa. So this is a whakapapa of eels. And if you follow that down from Ranginui and Papatūānuku, you'll see that eels are quite unusual in that they don't have a very long whakapapa. Humans, the last created in the iwi creation story, we have a fairly long whakapapa, sits below everybody else. And you'll see at the bottom of that slide, which will become important shortly, Rangitane have 109 named varieties of eel, there's a few of them listed there. Part of our stock assessment is trying to generate a photographic record of what each one of those eels looks like. Unfortunate for us.
Paul, can I interrupt you? Your slideshow is not, you're not clicking forward.
You're not seeing any of that?
Seeing advancing. So we've only still got the initial slide. Can you go to the next slide, slide two? And that's what you've, that is that the slide you've been talking about?
Let's see if this is going to make any difference. Oh, this might help.
Can you double click on from the current slide? Double click it. No, up at the top on the toolbar.
Hey Paul, try hitting F5.
F5.
Oh, you've got it.
Is it coming? Right.
Yeah, we can see the full screen now.
Oh, awesome. And have you got slide two?
Yep, all good.
Oh, awesome. Cheers for that.
Thank you, whoever that was. Oh, it was Jeff. Thank you.
Yeah, no, those contacts come in handy. As I said, that this is the area known to Rangitani, the four entities. And like I say, I'm employed by Rangitani or Manawatū there at the bottom, as the Tātek or Te Aotearoa Environmental Centre, a role I've been in 16 years. So this map, you can see that.
Yes, Paul.
Cool. Oh, yep. So those, it's a shotgun plot of the 700 known wahi tapu that we have in a GIS database. Like I say, 440,000 hectare rookery. If you squint really carefully, you can see a yellow line that cuts across. That cuts just south of Mangaweka, goes up the south bank of the Rangitika, across to a high point called Te Hekina, just south of Aorangi, and then down the spine of the range to the Taramea Trig in behind Levin, and then across to the Manawatū River. And each one of those little yellow spots is a known wahi tapu. So an occupied or an artifact find or an urupā or any of those. Like I say, I sort of got partway through this one. From Rangi Nui and Papatūānuku down to Tuna, and then the eels migrated from the Puna Kauariki, which is a heavenly swamp, to Waimauri, which is fresh water on our earthly realm, when the swamps in heaven were drying up. So, and those are the four main categories of freshwater tuna known. And then from that, Rangitani have 109 named varieties. So, and like I say, it's sort of the foundation for why we're doing a stock assessment and research in this space. So there are some of the other known whakapapa of tuna or eels, the European eels, Japanese eels, like I say, there's a whole heap of them, conger eels, they're all in the same whānau that descended from heaven, or the heavenly swamps to the earthly realm. So our talk will mainly focus on tuna species in New Zealand, and hopefully some of you will recognise a couple of those that aren't meant to be here or are not native to New Zealand. We have long fins, short fins, and the speckledy ones on the left-hand corner, and the one slide next to that are Australian longfin. And we sometimes get those that enter our waters in the returning heki of the baby eels. The one on the bottom left-hand corner is what's known as a golden eel. They're quite rare. And the middle top is a long fin, and that is one of the characteristics of identifying them, is when they bend, they have those corrugations form in the skin. Short fins don't do that. So this is the tuna life cycle. They go from New Zealand, enter the Hikorangi Trench, swim up it to the Tongan Trench. Takes them about 121 days. The interesting part in that kōrero is that they don't only swim the 4,500 kilometres in a straight line to reach a Tongan Trench. They swim a kilometre up and down in the water column daily. So it's an up and down 4,500 kilometre swim. So quite a significant distance. The eels, when they migrate, I'll do this bit first and then we can go back to the migration bit. So these are the, as you would have seen from my introduction, glass eels, and this is why they're called glass eels, the returning baby eels. They are transparent. These are the ones on the right hand side, and the one in the man's hand are a baby conger eel. the glass eels are only tiny. They can slip through the mesh of a whitebait net. And so the tooth formation at the top, you can even, so it'll become apparent later on in my talk, but they have a really distinctive tooth array. They top and bottom jaw and along the roof of the mouth, and they have teeth on their tongue, so you don't dare want to, that's why you don't put your finger in there. It can be quite a mission getting it out if they clamp shut, and they all point backwards, so anything that goes in there doesn't come out unless they regurgitate it, and I've had that happen a couple of times. So this is, so what you'll hear a kōrero about heki or the tuna heki. This is tuna heki weather for Rangitāne. So the first lightning storm around February is our tribal tohu or environmental signal for eels to go on the migration. The one on the left-hand side was an eel we picked up down at Himatangi. And you'll see the fins are quite black. The head is slightly deformed and the eyes are really large. And that's a way that we were able, that you can tell an eel that's going on a migration or one that isn't. So if they don't look like that, they're not going on a heki. The middle photograph is a male testes, and the right-hand photograph, and they don't quite match the kōrero down there on the Kaikōkapu, which is the stream at Himatangi. And so those are the ovaries. A female long fin of about 1.5 metres long can lay 7 million eggs. So one adult female can completely restock our adult fishery. And so you can imagine there's thousands and thousands of adult females go. And you would imagine there would be thousands, if not billions, of juvenile eels coming back to restock. So the question arises, why are our fishery, eel fishery, in such poor state? And that too is a sort of the foundation for why we wanted to do, conduct our own research into eel stocks. So to do that, we 2013 secured Ministry for Primary Industries Farming Sustainable Farming Fund money to conduct a two-year survey on glass eels. They're a poorly known fishery in New Zealand. Well, there is a little bit of information. It's a prohibited fishery, so we had to obtain a special permit from MPI to even conduct the research and do the trials that we did. I just looked up while we were waiting to start this presentation. So the glass eels are a delicacy in other countries, Japan, for instance, and Asia. They command a fairly high price, and the current market price as at 7:25 tonight is $2,000 a pound for glass eels. They were as high as $30,000 a kilo in 2013 when we were doing our research. So there's a fairly significant worldwide market outside of New Zealand and a number of significant fisheries, especially in the northern hemisphere, and some pretty scary stories. We had one of the fisheries managers from Maine in the US came over, and she was telling us and showed us a slideshow of some pretty heinous. Their Maine fishery is a $30 million industry. It runs for 2 weeks, and it's all conducted at about midnight in car parks in Maine at the supermarket, and dudes roll up with like a 6-inch across wad of $100 bills and buy fish, glass eels off fishermen. So yeah, ours is not quite that bad. But yeah, they turn up with a gun and a knife, those fellas. So, and as you can see, we did autopsy on that female eel, the top one there at the Kai Kokopu that we have the photo of. She was 20 years old and it had reached a length of 790 millimetres. I'll carry on. So for Rangitani, we have, part of the reason why the cultural information we have on eels generally in the Manawatū. So the name of the Manawatū region isn't the Manawatū. Its actual proper name is Te Tapere Nui of Whatonga, so the great food basket of Whatonga. And he recognised the huge fishery and bird life that inhabited the forested swamps when he came up the river in about 1350 or whenever the migration happens, which then connects us to that 800 years of occupation. And so these, we have some tribal stories about, I had a kaumā tour over in Tamaki Nui Arua. I suppose I should have mentioned that too. We have, as I say, the three North Island collectives of Rangitani, so Rangitani or Manawatū, Wairarapa and Tamaki Nui Arua, have a fishery entity each. And we, back in 2012, wrote a iwi fish plan that covers those three entities and their desires for their fishery interests, which cover all three elements, so cultural and customary, recreational and commercial. We're the only group that has that three-way interest. Iwi have a fairly significant role in terms of iwi fishery management, and that's like say, so we were, our research was to help inform our fisheries decisions. And so this kaumātua used to talk about a lake that Rangitani or what of Tamaki Nui Arua would stop at when they were visiting other whānau in Rangitani or Manawatū, and I could never find any evidence of the lake until I stumbled on the brown and white photograph in the gold frame there in the bigger picture in this frame. And I looked at that picture and I went, there's something wrong with that. I know exactly where that is and it doesn't look like that today. And so this is where the slip scar is that closed the gorge. So historically there was a lake there dammed up where Parahaki Island is, if anyone knows where that is. So that was the lake he was referring to, and they would stop there to replenish food stocks of eels and kākahi that they would take from the bed of the river at that point. The lower right-hand photograph shows a number of fishermen. These are Rangitani whānau. The unfortunate thing about them showing off those eels, and it'll be it's covered a little bit further down in my talk, those are all female eels, migrating females, which are now we have prohibited the fishing of within Rangitani or Manawatū. And they are subject to the MPI fishing restrictions for commercial fishers. And so the middle little image there is the Ministry for Primary Industries fishing quota management zones. So we fit in longfin eel 23 and longfin eel 11, I think it is. So these are the quota management units. The Chatham Islands has its own one. And Rangitani or Wairarapa and Tamaki Nui Arua sit within longfin 22. And then any of you that were privy to video that went viral in 2017, I think it was, or 16, of a massive eel seen from the Manawatū Bridge, that was it. it has been poo-pooed as unbelievable, but I'm about to show you a slide that makes sense as to why some of our rangitāne whānau thought that video was a true representation. So this is a number of historic photographs about fishing methods of rangitāne or iwi a bit back in the day, but predominantly rangitāne. So they were used to have what they call eel weirs, which are the structures in the river. You can see the watercolour one in the middle there where the naked gentleman's emptying a hinaki that was placed at the end of that structure to capture heki eels. And so, like I say, the number of Manawatū was a massive swamp that the two people in the little wooden dugout canoe in a flax swamp was from Horowhenua. And then the lower right-hand photograph is another fishing method called toi manu, because he's using a bird as a bait. And so there's a whole heap of them, toi nuku, which is baiting that fishing rod device with worms. And then, like say, toi nugi, which toi manu, which is baiting them with birds. But this is a watercolour observation by one of the early surveyors on the Whanganui, and it's at a place called it's up the Whanganui River. But as you can see, they're fairly significant size eel. They are certainly approaching that monster with some trepidation. As you can see, the warrior's pulling it up, and the other guy's ready to come down and hook a rope round it and stop it from returning to the water while it's still enticed by the bird. We have a number of cultural stories, and there's a town in Manawatū named for just such a taniwha. So he mātangi, or the fishing, where mātangi went fishing is the naming of he mātangi. There's a kōrero that mātangi was a rangitāne chief from the Wairarapa that heard of a great flock of birds and the Manawatū came across. The rangers looked down from Terohanga and did indeed observe a massive flock of birds flying around Te Tapere Nui up Whatonga. So he ventured down, followed the Manawatū River down, and then went up the coast and settled at He Mātangi. It wasn't called He Mātangi at that point. He sent word back for his whānau to come and visit, and none ever eventuated. He did eventually find out the reason why, and they were being devoured by a massive taniwha eel. And so he set about doing a fishing exercise similar to that depicted in the lower right-hand corner. So, like I say, the previous slide did have some credibility with our rangitāne stories, even though other people didn't. And as you can see from those four gentlemen with those eel, there's one there that's certainly longer than the fishermen, and those are all adult gentlemen holding those eels that they've caught. So yeah, so what happened to the rangitāne fishery? Well, as you can see, that middle photograph, you can't quite see it. So there is a little settler's cottage about halfway up the right-hand side of that photograph. And if you look really closely at the bottom, you'll see a gate and a boat. So that is what the Manawatū River looked like prior to settlement. And I thought it was sort of pertinent to include this photograph in this forum. So when they built the Fitzherbert Bridge back in the 40s, there was a flood that had gone through and exposed these mower footprints in the mud just right where they were building the Fitzy Bridge. So a Denornis giganticus, or whatever they call them, the giant mower had walked up the stream. So from prehistory through to colonisation, through to changes. So that right-hand photograph is poor Hanginau Valley, taken from just slightly downstream where they're building the road. Actually, I've got a contemporary photograph that will match that one. I just didn't include it. And the one, the bush camp down the bottom, is early colonisation of Fielding. So massive habitat change from prehistory through to colonisation. And those four images sort of cover that. Part of the popular belief is that, the habitat change, habitat loss, changes in the water quality, all of that sort of stuff, are what have decimated the Rangitane fishery. This left-hand photo is the Palmerston North Wastewater Discharge, visible on Google Earth. I see they've now changed that image. I was fortunate enough to capture that one and save that image. Like I say, it doesn't inspire a very nice mental image for Rangitane, having all of our wastewater being pumped into the river, and like I say, the whole management sort of cordial that can spring from that photograph. Our fishery in the current context has a number of impacts from, like I say, that whole massive landscape scale change through to modern influences and works in the river. This digger image I took from the internet just so that I didn't want to implicate any of our excavator community, but we've found through our research that activity, uncontrolled activity, is the single most detrimental thing currently taking place to our eel fishery. Like I say, that the last sort of part of that whole conversation is people certainly in my circles have proposed this thing about eels being kaitiaki tuna or tohu indicator species for water quality. I have a huge issue with that that sort of assertion. This is the Mangoni Stream in Palmerston North. I'll show you shortly. We've just completed a fishing there. But those two bottom images are the ones that I use as my I don't want to use tuna as a environmental indicator for the reasons I'm about to outline. So the first one is the Whangaehu River, flows out of the crater lake at Ruapehu, has a pH of about 5, so it's fairly acidic sulfuric acid, and not far from where it flows through Tangiwai, we have found eels, so short fin eels, and living in the river. So they'll cope with a pH of 5, and I certainly wouldn't be wanting any rivers in my patch to get to a pH of 5 and still have tuna and say, and they were healthy eels. At what point does the water quality then become so paru that that won't sustain life and using eels as the indicator? So like I say, that the pH issue is one. the second image there on the bottom is the home bush mastered in wastewater ponds. I was involved in a conversation about what they were going to do, swapping from the old wastewater pond system to this new one. And they had in the old pond system 150,000 actual eel population. That actually counted them. They were the most healthy fish I could come across. They were fairly fast growers, and it was a cycling population, so we had glass eels entering that scenario and adult fish going out on the heki on a regular basis in massive numbers. And again, I wouldn't want my water bodies to be in any sort of way, shape or form a wastewater pond quality, and having a massive eel fishery. And again, they were not anything like that that poor creature in the top right-hand corner that has obviously suffered some disease scenario. So like I say, using eels as an indicator species can be a really dangerous conversation without actual experience of what you're looking at. So this, like I say, you can see there's a foam plume washing down among oni. We have fished it. I have some pretty awesome data from there. It's a much healthier fishery than the Kahutarawa. It has more species, more number of cohorts of eels in it. We found coda. We've observed big schools of enanga. And like I say, that stream has just about every impact known to man on it, and regularly massively polluted. So our research has turned up some really crazy stuff. And then this one, and this becomes hugely important after I've discussed our glass eel projects, which I'm sort of coming up to next. So this is the current requirement for commercial fishers. So this is a fight net for catching eels. For those of you that haven't seen them before, they have a relatively small mesh, about a 10 mil mesh. And they have these two, they now have to have be adapted to have these two escape holes. One of them's 30 millimeter and the other one's a 45. To enable eels that are caught in that net to escape that are below those two size limits. And I'll just get you to remember that those two size classes, and as I go get further down in my conversation. So Rangitane glass eel fishing. So like I say, we did this 2-year study. As you can see, the two gentlemen up in the top left-hand side there, we're at on the Kai Kokopu. You can see the Himatangi surf life-saving building in the background there. These are our fight nets that we were using. The net faces downstream. You can't quite see it probably, but that is the catch bag at the back that's out of water. We fished two streams on this side, on the western side, and two streams on the eastern side. I was the field manager for two fishing crews this side, and the gentleman in the middle left-hand sequence in the green and black overalls, and we're holding two white nets with poles. Joe Putangaroa is my counterpart on the eastern side, and so he was in charge of two fishing crew on that side. This is most of our fishing was at night, so the bottom left hand image is a Mekis, who was one of the fishermen at the Whakataki. This is changes in the habitat at, that's the Whakataki estuary in the middle top. Joe Putangaroa, myself, and Josh Smith from NIWA, who is our one of our technical advisors. This is a small catch of glass eels. That's Terry Huppy and I, the lower right, mid right hand corner, removing logs from the Kai Kokopu. Joe involved a number of rangatahi from Rangitane of Wairarapa and Tamaki Nui Arua. And that's Joe Putangaroa and one of our other partners in the project. So we had we partnered up with NIWA, Aotearoa Fisheries, so that's John Jameson and his wife. John was our industry, he sits on the Eel Management Group board. And we had also Thesby Consulting, who were an aquaculture company, and I'll get to that part in a minute of why we had those three partners. So this is typical what we were doing at night, but this is a daylight set so that we could have we held a couple of workshops with our fisher people to sort of make sure we were all doing everything right and, you know, discussing problems. So this one, the wind has just blown in on a westerly, stiff westerly wind, and about to lift our net out of the water. They were 15 metre wings. We had a permit special, our part of the conditions of our special permit allowed us to block off the whole stream. It was quite funny. Our first day fishing, we had police turn up and they were going to arrest us. You can't have thing. And I said, no, we can actually. I don't want to know about it, the cop said. And I said, well, you do really, because we've got a special permit that enables us to do that. So unfortunately, the fisher people that were white baiting, complaining we had a net blocking off the whole stream, had no right to interfere in what we were doing. So yeah, we had a few interesting discussions with the locals. So we fished, where we imported these nets specially. They were on the main US fishing net design. We imported 9 of them from Australia. We got net makers over there to make them. They're about $9,000 each. And we broke one the first night we were out, which wasn't much fun. But it was quite funny watching it scoot all the way back up the Kai Kokopu, but not when we realised that we'd just munted a $9,000 net and it hadn't even caught, well, it did actually caught 150 glass eels in that one push. So we fished from early July through to December in the first year, and then we did similar time, but then the second year we only fished till early September. We targeted moon events, tide events, which were the same over the 2 years, so that we could compare our results. And like I say, we were either dark or at night. This was a training exercise. We'd found in the first year that the glass eels never invaded the stream in daylight. So it was all night fishing. Which made it a bit of a mission, because it was we had to wait for high tide, and we had two people at Kai Kokopu and one at the Puki Puki stream, which is north of heading towards Tangi Moana. And so I had to drive along the beach every night that we were fishing, about 20 minutes or an hour after high tide, and sometimes it was quite a mission, because they were quite regularly at fairly significant tide events. And this the lower right hand photograph is just a main fishing net design, just so you can get an idea of what they sort of look like. So these are the numbers that we caught in our process. So our glass eel research, we were looking at, so I've skipped a whole heap. So glass eels, like I mentioned, the single female can lay 7 million eggs. And so you can imagine there's a massive volume of glass eels that come back to New Zealand on the migration. And it's quite a feat, really, when you're looking at a metre and a half long female taking 161 days to swim to the Tongan Trench. Well, a glass eel, when it after it hatches, it's about 50 millimetres long, and it takes about the same time to swim back from Tonga to New Zealand. And they change from a little larvae thing called a leptocephala that looks like a willow leaf. They're quite flat and long, or well, not overly long, but sort of broad. And then as they get near the continental shelf, they morph into those little baby glass eel thingies that I showed you the earlier slides of. The unfortunate thing for glass eels is that 99% of them die at the high tide freshwater interface. So massive mortality. So of those trillions or billions of eels, baby eels that come back, only a tiny percentage make it and survive into as they cross from saltwater to freshwater in the estuarine environment. And so our adult population is based on that less than 1% that survive. So it becomes, that's the reason why our adult fishery is in decline, is that we have massive changes in the population structure. And so we looked at, can we manipulate that 99% mortality and the billions that come and grow those to mature, or to market size in aquaculture, in an aquaculture scenario. And that was why we had an aquaculture consultant. Niwa run our science part of it, and the iwi were responsible for the mātauranga part. And the fishery, Aotearoa Fisheries had provided John Jameson in sort of two capacities, as a commercial fisher person. So he knew the fishing industry and the requirements of, what the market limitations and all that sort of stuff were. But also he had the contacts of where we could easily source fishing devices. So John had hooked us up with the nets. And so what we did is in the two smaller streams, because they were manageable and we could have a net that would block off, so we knew we were catching, once we'd refined our technique, we were catching everything that was invading. And we'd done a whole, basically a whole month's worth of fishing in the first year, daylight fishing, night fishing, so we knew there was nothing coming in the daylight. They were all coming at night after dark on the high tide. So we did a whole heap of thingies, and as you can see from this slide, we were fishing from July through to December in this year, because we found that it had changed. And so the first year we had thought we'd cracked it. And I'll show you the slide shortly. We had two heki went. So our heki in 2013 was late in the Manawatū. Like I say, the lightning storms didn't come till the end of May. So that triggered the heki. They went out. But the rest of New Zealand had a migration earlier. And so we got two inflows of massive peak, or not massive peaks, but distinct peaks of catch, basically 3 months apart. So we knew that the second wave that were coming were from our Manawatū heki. And so we thought, we know what we're doing this year. And so the second year, this year that was up on the board there, we knew nothing much coming into the Manawatū. As you can see, we got 31 as compared to the East Coast, 3 and 2. And then in August, we had a significant jump because we had only the single hecky this year. September, they sort of started tailing off. October, they're still tailing off. And then November, over in Castle Point, they had a significant jump in catch. And so what we figured out is that they get washed through the Cook Strait, and then the currents take them up the East Coast. So their invasions usually a couple of months after ours. Well, it can be depend really. It can be a couple of weeks later. In the first year, it was only a couple of weeks. But in this one, as you can see, the weather currents were quite different. And so the second peak for November was quite late. So year two, we thought we'd cracked it. We got more money from MPI into the third year. And that completely mucked up both our technique and our cockiness about that we knew what glass eels did. So in our process, we took 50% of whatever we caught. So we waited till August because 15 eels isn't a representative sample. And we took 50%. They were transported to holding mini aquaculture facility at Orangi, and the remaining 50% were liberated further upstream in the stream that they'd entered into as a means of getting them past. And if anyone's watched, or you know, goes on from this to watch some YouTube videos on glass eels, you'll see some Māori whānau asserting that they, you know, they like salmon, that they come back to the same stream that their parents were from. And that is totally not our observation. We've watched baby glass eels coming into the Kai Kokopu, and if you've seen it, it's not a very fast flowing stream. And they take about 20 minutes to go a metre up the stream, and they hit the cross current and get washed away, and that's their that attempt fail. They then get washed down to the next stream down and have a crack there. And then, like I say, if they make their way all the way around to the East Coast and up through Coromandel, so their part is quite late in the recruitment phase. And so, yeah, glass eels have, they have no, not the strength or the ability to swim against any kind of current, so they rely solely on tidal surges to get them in. And, yeah, so like I say, they don't come back to the stream that their adults lived in. They just wherever they can make it, they make it. And if they don't and get blown further out, well, they end up in the Chatham Islands. And then beyond that, they end up fish food. So this is one of the other techniques that we used. Aside from those fight nets, we found that fishing effort at Castle Point worked better with these scoop nets, which were also specially made. And this just outlines the numbers caught comparing our scoop netting at Castle Point with scoop netting with and fishing with fight nets. So these guys got pretty proficient in catching glass eels with these scoop nets. So this is the West Coast numbers. So we'd like to say we fish Puke Puke Stream, Kai Kokopu. And these are the comparisons between the 2 years. So the dashed line is the 2013 year, and the orange line is the 2014 year. And as you can see on the Kai Kokopu, we got a big catch, and then it tailed off, and then a massive catch in mid-October, which was corresponded with our other hecky. And so, yeah, we were pretty cocky by this stage. This is the Whakataki and the Kaikokapu, the Castle Point, and as you can see there, spikes are late November. So quite a delay. So the bags underneath, I'll just explain. So that's how we transported them. We put them in chili bins with ice. We pumped up these bags with straight oxygen to enable them to stay oxygen, the hot water to stay oxygen saturated while we transported them. Those are probably 1,000-odd baby eels in each one of those bags. But this is the percentage of catch in 2014 for each one of the streams that we fished for longfin out of the glass eels that were caught when they were doing the survey. So 90% of the sample in 2014 was shortfin eels, and we had more longfins on the west coast. This is our cumulative catch. So we caught, try and get the numbers right. So we had 13,000 eels we caught the first year, 17,000 the second year, and then the third year when we got more funding, we I think we ended up with 54,000. And like I say, it completely, it was the whole thing just fell apart. In terms of what we thought we knew. And so like I say, these are the 50% line were the ones that we took for the aquaculture trial. And so like I say, there were a number of environmental factors that affected glass eel recruitment. These are the moon phase and our catch rates for the four different streams. Bycatch was pretty similar for both years. We caught 16,000 whitebait. So people that fish for whitebait and the thing, there's a significant number coming after the year. Told to go home. So there is a lesser effect of because we have tribal stories of catching sugar fadges full of whitebait even before they even get up the streams. So the numbers there were what we caught in the nets while we were glass eel fishing. We caught some unusual fish. These lamprey, were the first ones that we had known of in that whole fishing exercise, and I'll come to that bit at the end. We had caught 5,000 more whitebait in the second year than we did, but less bullies and less smelt, and certainly less baby flounder. So the Kaikokapu is a pretty significant flounder hatchery, we found out. Now we jump to the, this is the Whakataki, because we tried to do a survivorship survey of what we knew were going up those streams. So the Castle Point, we had two sites in the upper Castle Point and one a lower point in the catchment, and we were trying to compare the two to see how far and what numbers had made it upstream. So this is the top left-hand photo is Whakataki upper research site. The second one was in farmland, quite different. So we found corresponding sites on the Castle Point so that we could compare the sites. This is typical middle Castle Point. You'll see from there that the eel numbers were. So this was 2014 and 2015. And 2015, the density numbers had gone up quite a bit. And but still predominantly short fins. But yeah, fairly significant redfin bully habitat, the Castle Point. And we actually found a fish, a spawning ground for redfin bullies on the Castle Point. So this is the second site on the Castle Point. We added one further up in the catchment. But you can see there still significant numbers of short fin. But we started turning up banded kokopu, but still significant redfin bully habitat. And these are the numbers for the lower Whakataki, and you can see there 381 redfin bullies, and they were all about 20 millimetres long, and we counted that exact number. And it was a major mission. This is a typical redfin bully spawning habitat, this one. So like I say, it was a fairly significant find in terms of identifying spawning grounds for redfin bullies. But again, as you can see, fairly heavily slanted towards short fins. This is an upper Whakataki, and as you can see, we've now got the swap because this is more ideal habitat for long fin, being a quite fast flowing cobble bottom fishery, but still significant redfin habitat. We did a number of sort of thingies. We got fairly proficient at removing otoliths from adults. I can do them down to an eel that's 20 centimetres long or smaller, about 115 centimetres long, but these ones on the left-hand side are glass eel otoliths. So as you can see, the year one, there's only that top one's a one-year-old. The second one down is a not one-year-old on the Castle Point, and the Whakataki again. These are 40-year-old males, long fin. That migrant that I was showing you earlier on, that was a 20-year-old, that's the otolith from that fish, the short fin one we picked up on Manawatū Coast. And this is the number of eels that we did. We did on the Castle Point 60 eels, the Whakataki 85. On the Kaikōrapu 20, we were unable to get any for Pukipuki. And it's a destructive sampling process, but it gave us very valuable information on what the age structure of our population are. And so this is the population structure for short fins and long fins. Pretty typical, really. We did this 2 years running. Heap of short fins. We had 325-ish short fins that were in the 50 to 90 millimeter long. Which are little baby ones, and as they get bigger, so the 250 to 299 millimetres, we have down to one or two. On the Whakataki there, it's a similar number. So glass eel is, should have mentioned that. So 105-ish millimetres long, typically. 75 millimetres long. So the 100 millimetre ones are the first year alvas, and then, like I said, not they sort of tail off quite rapidly due to mortality. We were able then to develop these. There's a straight line correlation between weight and length up to 600 or 700 millimeters, depending on weight and length. And so that's what these two graphs generate. And so if that's pretty much a straight line, they conform to the national standard. So if it sort of went up and then tailed off, they would be non-conformists. So this is for the kai kōkapu. These ones that are specially marked here were the ones that were in that slide previously, back up at the start of the process. And so the, these ones that were 800 millimetres long were the ones that we had that were roughly 20 years old. And they'd gone on the hickey. So there's a number of factors that that we also did. We were fortunate enough to have an internationally renowned tuhunga on eels help us with our training and our research. So Jack Bube, if anybody has heard of that guy, Don Jellyman's another one that Jack is Don Jellyman's contemporary. And so Jack, as part of our information gathering, enlightened us to a problem that so there's not only the habitat loss and the thing, there's a whole heap of animal sort of impacts that can affect the ability for the eels to swim from here to Tonga, or go on the migration. So this was a dissection of a short fin eel in the Pōhangina catchment. You see these little black threads, what they call a swim bladder parasite. So they're an intestinal a bladder worm that punctures the swim bladder, so the eels are infected aren't able to regulate their buoyancy. And so, like I say, they're a massive impact. And so we were looking for, when we were doing the condition scoring, identifying whether they're male, female, all of that sort of stuff, looking for what they'd been eating and whether they were infected with this bladder parasite. So the eels are pretty awesome beasties to study. The gentleman in the red coat there, Don Jellyman, one of our Niwa tohunga on eel research, holding a adult female long fin from Lake Ellesmere in the South Island. So they usually poke fun at us North Islanders that they have massive eels in the South Island. Well, as you can see from the right-hand side, no, we have some pretty good size ones there too. So the lady in the top there, Anka Zernak, was our project manager. This was a 1.5 metre long eel, 11 kgs, we caught at the swimming hole up in the Pōhangina. And the one in the middle, like I say, is they are reasonably, I wouldn't like to say common, but you do turn them up. I found a puddle up in the Whangamomina River that had six of these golden eels. And that's another story. And that photo at the bottom, so we're pretty high tech. We have run our own electric fishing gear, so we can front foot it with the best of them. And so, like I say, that conversation I was saying about these two aperture sizes is one of the major outcomes from our the outcome from our eel research, part of the reason, like I say, we were looking at options for better protecting our adult population. So if we could manipulate this 90% mortality or 99% mortality, take a portion of that quota and or quantum, grow them in aquaculture to a market size, could we command generate a sustainable fishery in that aquaculture scenario? And could we look at then retiring our adult population from the commercial catch entirely? Because like I say, it's based on 1% of what invades. So yes, the outcome was we can grow them to market size. We can actually command a premium price. So the New Zealand eel commercial sale of eels commands a pretty stink price, and they're pretty hard to sell on the international market because for two reasons. They have a funny taste depending on what river they were caught from or habitat, and the skin's too coarse for commanding a premium price because they obviously live in rocky riverbeds and cope with they have to develop a fairly tough skin to be able to burrow down through rocky substrate or into mud and all that sort of stuff. So like I say, nobody wants to buy our eels unless they're heavily smoked and processed. So can we that was why we were looking at this whole process. And yes, we can grow eels and overcome both of those thingies. And so we did we were fortunate enough to get a chef that had been trained in how they create eel dishes in China and Japan, and they they're a live eel. They take out of a bucket, and within about 3 seconds it's on the barbecue and thingy after they've killed it. And so we got him to cook us up. We got comparable size eels, so the ideal eel size is a diameter about the size of a English, our sausage, meat sausage, and an eel that's about 400 millimeters long, or 40 centimeters, is the premium market size. And as you've seen from those life information graphs, that some of them take 20 years to grow to that in the natural scenario. So if you grow them in aquaculture, we can get them to attain that size within 18 months by manipulating the food and the water temperature and the water quality. And that overcomes so they don't have the ability to burrow into a substrate, and you can control the water quality that nullifies the funny taste. And so the thing, and so yeah, we got this guy to cook up some wild caught eels and some that we had left over from after we'd released. We kept about 30 eels, I think it was, out of several thousand that we released back into the wild. And so he rolled up with he did the wild caught ones, and they were amazing. And the way that they do them overseas, and we couldn't, these are, pretty primo. And then he brought out the aquaculture eels, and I'm a complete convert after that. I quite like eating eel, but the difference was just astronomical between the two. The glass eel was, aquaculture eels were just melt in your mouth. You could eat the skin without any dramas. It was, and they were just amazing flavour.
Paul, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to sort of interrupt you, and we're going to have to wrap it up. So could we leave the lampreys for another time, so that we can actually, if anybody has any questions.
Yeah, yeah. I'm almost, Yeah, you're almost at the end, about another 2 or 3 minutes to just about do it, if that's okay.
Yeah, and then, as I say, then because at 9 o'clock we're going to get cut off.
Oh, no, that's cool. So, yeah, so the other outcome, like I say, this becomes hugely important in that life scenario is that, actually, I think it's on this next slide. Oh, yeah, that one. So that, if anyone's familiar with the bell curve, there's some, like say, the poor performers, high performers, and the average ones in the middle. So the poor performers are the ones that escape out of those holes, and we could have eels that would take 200 to 300 years to attain 40 centimetre length coming up in our next lot of in our managed eel fishery. And that was one of the take-home messages from our research from that process, is that even though they've come up with this device that's supposedly making them like I say, that commercial fishing practice now is about to decimate our eel population, is the take-home message from that one. So I'll just skip quickly through this one. So we, as part of another project doing fishery research in Palmerston North, involves that craziness, not always ideal habitat. The thingy on the right-hand side is the little Mangoni through on Wood Street. We put microchips in the eels so that we can track where they go in our water system. This is, if you're familiar with it, Urban Eels, and the eel feeding platform. This was it being constructed. This is it now, and the red arrow indicates something we found that triggered our next sort of look at what we needed to do in terms of research. So that was a bucket full of lamprey we recovered just on 300 out of that spot. So as Anthony indicated in the beginning, I might touch on these lamprey. Ours are Pacific lamprey.
Sorry to interrupt you again. I think, can we leave this for another talk? Because if anybody has any questions, I should really like to wrap it up now, if it's possible.
Oh, yeah, no. I've only got 2 more slides after this one.
Well, yeah, we're coming close to being cut off totally. Yeah.
I'm aware of that. I've got the time ticking away on the bottom. So, some awesome facts there about lamprey. These are what we know about lamprey in the current context. So 300 plus in the Tutitia, 1 in the Kudarawa. Death Valley is just down from Russell Death's house, and we caught 15. So that's what we've got on historical information on lamprey. We've got nothing. There's no reference to them in our thingy. This is knowledge that we know now, that we know we've got them. And so, yeah, so any questions?
Yeah. Well, Paul, before we get totally cut off, I should like to thank you very, very much for such an informative talk. I've learned a hell of a lot, and I'm sure a lot of people tuning in have as well. Does anybody, can you switch off your screen, please, Paul, if it's possible? Does anybody actually have any questions?